placement cost. And is what
that,
is, sorry?
Is that factor in technological change?
It factors in technological change at, there are two parameters of technological change which were involved. One is 3% rate of technological change in respect of total factor productivity growth, and 1.5% technological change per year in autonomous energy efficiency parameter. But since we are dealing with specific technologies, an expert judgment was taken on the limits of technological
crossovers between technologies.
Yeah, so the model gives you these crossovers, and actually the technological change in particular technology stops at a level indicated as the maximum practicable limit, you know, indicated by expert judgment. So what we also have here is the energy system cost, and again we have, you know, for 20% reduction it is $499 billion. So we are not talking of small money here. But if we go to actually a CG modeling result, which I have not shown here for the reason that, for a logistic reason that I could not locate it in my, you know, on my office computer, you know, before coming here, but I can, you know, share these results with
were
you.
Were there any other benefic effects on the economy other than the CO2 greenhouse gas reduction? For instance, that level of 499 or whatever, that billion
no.
investment.
When you talk of beneficial effects on the economy, you have to look at the CG results. I don't have the CG slides here, but I mean, I just somehow was not able to locate them in my computer before, you know, when I was putting this thing together. But let me tell you what it is. It is actually that once you divert these investments away from other productive sectors into energy, and you also have an increased energy system cost, then for about a 10% reduction in from the baseline, you would have to have something like a $4 trillion cumulative GDP impact up to 2030. So that's the kind of GDP impact that is involved.
Of 10%.
Of about 10%, yeah. The CG model actually breaks down at 9.6%. So now let's look at the global politics. Now, first of all, let me disillusion a whole pile of particularly young minds out here that the climate change negotiation is about saving the world. They are nothing of the sort. They have never been anything of the sort. All negotiators from all countries work on this premise that these are actually the mother of all economic negotiations. The economic impacts of climate change regimes will dwarf the economic outcomes of the WTO negotiations. And it is to determine future global economic patterns and strategic potentials. That's what the negotiations are about. No negotiator is under any illusion that this is what he is negotiating and not this. Well, we start our story with finger pointing. Who's responsible? Is a problem? Who caused it? And this is an exercise that we did in Terry on historical responsibility for climate change, because I'm mentioning this because, you know, this has been cited very extensively in the negotiations, you know, to buttress the developing country perspective that the major share of the effort must come from developed countries. And what we see is that when we have the bars going to the right, then those countries have a positive responsibility. That is, they have actually contributed to the problem. If the bars go to the left, then they have a negative responsibility. Countries have lived within their environmental space. Now, you know, if there's interest, I can, you know, discuss the methodology behind this. But there are several, you know, sort of interesting things that we derive from this graph. This is based on a database which you can access from the WRI, from the World Resources Institute website. What we see is that all the developed countries have a positive responsibility, and all the developing countries have a negative responsibility. To some extent, the developed and developing country dichotomy is said to be artificial. But if you look at, if you actually sum up, you know, if you actually tot up their contribution to climate change, there is a very neat separation.
What are the units on the scale? What are those numbers?
Okay, then I have to go to the methodology.
No, just tell me what the numbers stand for.
The numbers actually stand for the aggregate emissions from 1850 to 2005 in millions of gigatons of CO2 equivalent.
Normalized for the whole world.
Sorry? No, it's
divided
not.
Divided by the whole world.
No, it's not. Yeah, it's just the absolute sum. But above a certain threshold of sustainability.
Okay.
And once you do that, you know, this is. But let me come to some further lessons. The US, no surprise, they have had the maximum footprint. But what we see is that the top one is India, the low one is China. Either China or India have provided the entire environmental space used by the US with enough to spare.
By default or by design?
By fact.
By history. History is you know, a complex of default and design, of fate and circumstance and free will and so on. But it reflects history. The second is that China and India taken together, leave out the others, have provided the entire environmental space used by all the developed countries and then some. Now, this is a sample of the countries, but the entire database, you know, which is actually available on Terry's website, gives it for all 160 countries. So when I make this statement, I'm saying aggregating overall, you know, sort of developed countries. So let me not go into the structure of the UNFCCC and the Kyoto Protocol and so on, but let me get to the story of Copenhagen. But just one preface, that the entire climate change regime from the UNFCCC onwards is premised on a certain very clearly articulated principle, that of common but differentiated responsibilities and respective capabilities. And the reason why I cited this data on historical responsibility is actually, you know, to give an empirical foundation to operationalizing this principle of common but differentiated responsibility. So we had the UNFCCC in 1992, which came into force in 1994. It was a framework agreement. It set up only very aspirational targets for reductions by developed countries. Of course, excepting for the Soviet Union, which collapsed, not one developed country was on track to meet that target, which was to get back to 1990 levels of emissions by 2000. Not one country accomplished that. Not one developed country accomplished that. In 1997, we had the Kyoto Protocol, which was a legally binding protocol calling for reductions of greenhouse gas emissions by developed countries, individual targets for each developed country, aggregating to 5.2%. And guess what? The United States stayed out. The United States Congress passed a unanimous resolution that the US will not ratify the Kyoto Protocol until and unless there are comparable emissions reductions commitments on the part of China and India. Well, that was the stated reason, because it had a certain political resonance. China was even at that time emerging as a serious economic threat, but they could not be seen as just targeting China. So they had to put somebody else also in dock with China. The Kyoto Protocol had a very tortured course because of the US withdrawal to ratification. And the key country which had to be roped in to get ratification was Russia, because the Kyoto Protocol had a certain structure that 75% of the countries responsible for emissions of the emission, that countries 75% of the emissions have to ratify, and 50% of all countries. They could not reach the target without Russia. Russia had a major internal debate on A, whether in fact the narrative of anthropogenic influence on the climate is scientifically established. There was an influential body of scientific opinion in Russia which said that it's not that CO2 concentrations are resulting in increased elevated temperatures, but it is the other way around, that elevated temperatures are happening because of natural circumstances, and that it is the natural changes which is causing an increase in emissions of CO2 and methane from natural sources. And that was a very real, it was a very real honest scientific debate. A second was a policy debate, that climate change, after all, Russia is one of the coldest countries on earth with more than half its territory under permafrost, and that puts all kinds of, you know, impose all kinds of costs and technological restrictions on getting at the huge, you know, mineral resources of Russia, and, you know, also of significantly increasing its agricultural potential. So there was again an honest political debate in Russia as to whether in fact climate change is beneficial for Russia. Ultimately, Russia at some point in time became economically vulnerable. It had to default on its sovereign debt. And there was some arm twisting by the European Union, as a result of which Russia acceded and the Kyoto Protocol became legally enforceable. But the point is that the US still stayed out, Australia stayed out. The government of Canada, although it was a party to the Kyoto Protocol, took no steps to implement it, and its emissions, you know, went up humongously. Again, a very major emitter. And there were these concerns about the rise of China, and maybe 20 years later that of India, which would rival which would result in a huge shift in economic and strategic power to the East. So the agenda became one of getting the US and China and India on board into an international discipline. And so even before the Kyoto Protocol ratification happened in 2005, each of the annual conferences of parties, and particularly this pressure became immense in 2001 during the 8th conference of parties at the Kyoto Protocol, which was held in New Delhi. And somehow there was a sense that India would be so strongly committed to getting a positive outcome of these negotiations at New Delhi. They would not like to see this negotiating session as a failure, that it would then be willing to accede to a process of negotiations leading to international disciplines. And I think Sudhinji would remember these episodes very well, when Sudhinji and I drafted the Prime Minister's address to the Conference of Parties, where it was made entirely plain that India was not going to be a party to starting any such process, and that while we would welcome a positive outcome of these negotiations, that we are willing to risk a failure of the negotiations at New Delhi risk the international opprobrium in order, you know, in order to ensure that such a process does not happen. And instead, we suggested the alternative agenda, that now the time has come to focus on what is the real agenda of developing countries, which is adaptation, not mitigation. And so we did have an outcome. We did have the Delhi Declaration. And the Delhi Declaration, and you can get it out of the web, is the first major document which actually brings the focus back onto adaptation. Still now, adaptation had been something of a Cinderella of the climate change regime. The whole focus was on mitigation. So there were several sessions, you know, COP9, COP10, COP11, COP12, and in each of these COPs, each of these conference of COPs means conference of parties, annual conference of parties, the question of starting a new negotiating process to bring, and of course it was diplomatically worded, a comprehensive global approach. Comprehensive is the code word for the US, but US doesn't come on board without China and India, and in any case there was the agenda of getting China and India onto an international discipline. So finally in Bali in COP13 in 2007, the Bali roadmap was agreed. But it was agreed after India insisted on absolutely, you know, crystal clear language, emphasizing the principle of common but differentiated responsibility and the specific and ensuring that the balance of obligations and responsibilities set out in the UN Framework Convention on Climate Change, particularly in Article 4, was not disturbed. Essentially what that meant is that actions which developing countries take, that they are required to be provided the financial resource and technology by developed countries to the extent of agreed full incremental costs, and if these resource and technology are not forthcoming, then developing countries could not be held to account for accomplishing, you know, their action plans. And this structure was maintained intact. But the Bali roadmap set out two negotiating tracks. The Kyoto Protocol itself provided that this 5.2% reduction would happen in the period 2008 to 2012, but it also required that negotiations have to start from 2005 on a second commitment period, the period beyond 2012. So the Bali roadmap continued, the negotiations had actually started. And it continued for, it gave the mandate to continue these negotiations for the second commitment period, and there were also some additional amendments to the Kyoto Protocol which were proposed. But the main negotiating track is negotiations not under the Kyoto Protocol but under the UN Framework Convention for what is called the long-term cooperative action. Long-term cooperative action on a globally comprehensive basis, again signifying that we need to get in not all players will have international disciplines on mitigation, but they will all be involved in some way, and long term in the sense that now we are looking at time frames of up to 2050. And there were 9 negotiating sessions held between Bali in December 2007 till we got to Copenhagen in December 2009. So probably of all the major international negotiating processes, much more negotiating effort was spent on this process than almost on any other that I can think of. But you know, sometimes it is said that the negotiation did not make much progress. What we have to understand is that the issues are extremely complex. They go to the heart of countries' development and economic aspirations and interests. And under the tracks, very detailed negotiating documents were developed. A 65-page document under the first track, AWG stands for Ad Hoc Working Group, KP stands for Kyoto Protocol, and this is Ad Hoc Working Group on Long-Term Cooperative Action. And in the second track, a 260-page negotiating document. Both documents you can download from the web. And these contain, they address, the second one addresses five building blocks. It addresses the question of mitigation, the question of adaptation, finance, technology, and what is termed the long-term vision as to what is the level of stabilization and what is the basis for apportionment of responsibilities between different countries. So now let's get to Copenhagen. I'm still by the Bali roadmap. Now, slow progress was made, but as I said, progress was made. But, you know, countries are coming from very different, you know, standpoints. And what had happened is that these negotiating sessions had become so acrimonious that there was a great deal of mistrust about each other's intentions. But when you come to Copenhagen with these two extremely voluminous documents, it is clear that closure is not feasible at Copenhagen. You cannot sort out all the alternatives, all the sub-alternatives, all the counter-proposals and get to an agreed text in Copenhagen. It takes hours and days to actually formulate one single sentence in these agreements.
Yeah.
I think you saw it at Johannesburg.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Now, so when this became clear, then the idea was mooted by several countries that Copenhagen should yield a political declaration and then give a mandate that negotiations under both tracks are to continue. And the idea was that this political accord would be negotiated in a smaller group, because when you try to reach consensus among 160 countries, then consensus becomes difficult. But to my point of view, it is worth making that effort, because the consensus that is reached then becomes stable. But anyway, I think you guys must have watched the TV coverage of the Copenhagen negotiations, and how for the first time a major international document was directly negotiated at the levels of heads of state and government. So we have the Copenhagen Accord, which is just a 3-page document. But that was a document in which Prime Minister Manmohan Singh, the UK Prime Minister, President Obama, Nicolas Sarkozy, Angela Merkel, the Russian Prime Minister, that they were actually doing the commas and the full stops and doing the sentence formulation. It has never ever happened before in the history of international negotiations. But then we had the accord, which was agreed in a small group. Accede to it, see, I would be politically committed to this accord. But it will require further negotiations before it can be operationalized, if at all. And as it looks now, that it is not going to be directly operationalized. And in fact, I'll just come to what has happened to that accord in a little while. And it cannot be operationalized in the UNFCCC, and it cannot be. And in fact, now, you know, the way that it has moved, it is not to be operationalized in and of itself. But let us look at the Copenhagen Accord and what India's positions were prior to Copenhagen. The first prior position was that no legally binding commitments for developing countries. No legally binding commitments for mitigation or for provision of finance. And the Accord said that developed and developing countries have differentiated political commitments, and the legally binding nature of these commitments is unclear. So, for example, India has made a political commitment of a 20-25% reduction in emissions intensity outside the agriculture sector between 2005 and 2020. Now, it is unclear as to whether this is legally binding, but clearly India, having communicated this, this target, has taken on a political commitment which is every bit as serious as a legally binding commitment. A second aspect of India's prior position was allocation of global environmental space on the basis of equal per capita entitlements. Not here and now, but at the point at which we seek to stabilize the global emissions. Say if we want to stabilize global emissions by 2050, then by 2050 we must have that carbon space allocated on equal per capita basis. The Copenhagen Accord does not make any explicit allocation of carbon space, It calls for a 2-degree goal of stabilization, and it concedes that it is to be based on equity. What is the precise formulation of equity? That is a matter which will continue far into the future. Another of India's positions was that we cannot speak of a peaking year for India's emissions. We have to grow for the foreseeable future. At this point in time, we cannot indicate or take a commitment on when our emissions would peak. The Copenhagen Accords provides a concept of peaking for developing countries. But for developing countries, it is premised on the overriding priority of social and economic development and poverty eradication. It does not give a date, but it concedes that, well, countries will peak depending on their ability to address these challenges. Another of India's prior positions was developed countries to collectively reduce their emissions by at least 40% below 1990 levels by 2020. The accord gives no collective target for developed countries, and the individual countries were to indicate their targets by 31st of January this year. Many of them have done so. And this was a sore point between the EU and the US, without any comparability of effort among them. But the presently indicated targets that have been given fall far short of this collective target. And this target is actually based on the UNFCCC findings. It is not something which has been pulled out of hat. It draws from the UNFCCC findings. Another of India's positions was that no international scrutiny, especially of adequacy of domestic actions which do not receive international finance and technology support. What we do on our own, we cannot have international scrutiny of whether they are adequate, whether they are the right measures, and whether they have, we have been actually able to implement them. But you say that we can accept international monitoring, international measurement, reporting and verification where we have actions which are internationally supported. So if you have received for some programs or projects, we have received international financing and technology, we are perfectly prepared for international verification. What the court says is that with respect to domestic actions, there are to be international consultations and analysis, but under clearly defined guidelines that respect national sovereignty. And this is to be done after domestic measurement, reporting and verification, and reporting to the UNF Framework Convention on Climate Change. So this position, in fact, has been considerably amended, and the scope of international consultation and analysis, to what extent this leaves autonomy of policy making and policy action with us, is a matter of, you know, concern, and a matter, it will be something which, you know, we have to play our cards very, very carefully here. Of course, for internationally supported actions, then MRV is, you know, is acceptable both by us, and it's also there in the Copenhagen Accord.
What is the meaning of international consultations?
Well, the content of that has to be negotiated. It says international consultation and analysis under clearly defined guidelines which respect national sovereignty. What are these guidelines? Do these consultations involve second guessing of our policies and measures? You know, those are important issues that have to come up. So the expression is there, the content is not defined at this point in time, and the further course of negotiations will seek to define this content.
It's essentially a policy influencing move.
Well, certainly we would interpret the developed country insistence on consultation and analysis as requiring international accountability for implementation, but international guidance for policy making, even for domestic actions which do not require international support, which are not undertaken without international support. So it's a very, very disturbing element to my mind of the Copenhagen Accord, because this is one place where, without an international commitment, you know, our autonomy of policy making seems to have, we seem to have yielded space, for an international accountability and international international oversight of what we are doing on policy.
That in a way kind of undermines sovereignty.
Well, you see, that's a philosophical question, because you know, every time a country, you know, sort of enters into an international agreement, it is ceding a part of its sovereignty. You know, it is constricting its policy choices. But the disturbing factor out here is that domestic action, these are not internationally negotiated, these are not international commitments. So we have you know, seem to have opened the door for some kind of circumscription of our policy autonomy with respect to strictly domestic actions. These are not international commitments.
I mean, there are two ways to look at it. Firstly, I think you remember that we can also do reciprocate on the developed countries what is implicit here. It's not a power relationship. I mean, we can, for example, go to the US and say, look, you shouldn't have football stadiums, you know, that are air conditioned in the middle of the summer. 80,000 people sitting in air conditioned stadiums. That's, you know, that's wastage of energy. I'm just giving that as an example. It's reciprocal. It's not that only the developed countries are looking at the developing countries. Developing countries can also look at their policies. And you know, countries have been saying for a long time that US energy is the most under-taxed energy sector in the world. You know, that comes up then for analysis and discussion. So it's not, it's mutually ceding of authority. The other way to look at that last point is, you know, under the IMF's Article 4, Articles of Association, it's a routine.
You want the mic?
Reports that, no, I don't need. It's a routine way of checking into each other's policies, and it does not mean that you have to do what the staff says or not to.
Yeah.
So.
The ultimately the proof of the pudding is
when it happens.
You know, is when it happens. And I mean, the point is that we have to be very, very careful. We have to be on our guard not to get involved in a model by which we give space for international dictation of our policies.
But the way information share is happening in the world today, a lot of it is anyway open domain knowledge. I mean, if we are doing something, say with our garbage landfill site, if we pass a contract, we are saying a CDM contract, all of it immediately goes on to an UNFCCC website and it's available for scrutiny around the world. So even without, I mean, that fear is a bit heightened, I think, that there is inclusion.
No, there's
disclosure happening on its own also.
Yeah, it's not a question of disclosure. You know, it's a question ultimately of, supposing we have adopted a solar policy of 12 rupees feed-in tariff. And, you know, we have a group of people, some consultants appointed, who come and look at the policy and say that, no, you should actually be having a 20 rupees feed-in policy, feed-in tariff. And that, you know, a lot of pressure is brought to bear on us. You know, and the point is that it becomes a power relationship because our capacity to put pressure on the other side is highly asymmetrical.
It's changing.
It is changing.
How can you put pressure on the other side? How can a poor country?
No, but that's it. The point that I was making.
Sir, you are talking about international cooperation.
They are manipulating the policies of the poor nations. And where is maneuvering? Where is the
cooperation? That's exactly what I was saying.
Yeah.
I was saying that the power relationships are asymmetric. That is the cause of concern. In theory, it is reciprocal. The world as we know it is asymmetric. Okay? I'm in agreement,
sir, because you are saying, shown all these statistics, sir, when the policies of the government doesn't touch the poor man, how does those officials go and get these statistics? You are saying it's a political chemistry. So how does mobiles, TVs, all the luxuries reach the villages but not electricity, roads, healthcare, education?
Yeah,
sir,
okay, I mean, that's
you are saying, sir, drought and prone, sir, the rich people live in the rich places, the poor people are in the flooding and all, they get killed, not the poor people.
Yeah, on this particular issue, it was in the international context. It was a kind of focused discussion. Okay, then we have several more. Financial mechanism under the financial mechanism, you know, under the climate change regime was in India's view to be under the guidance and accountability of the Conference of Parties. And this was to be not on the paradigm of aid, which is complete at the discretion of the donor countries, but on the paradigm of responsibility, because it's differentiated responsibility that lies at the heart of the, you know, UNFCCC. And so this would involve assessed and not discretionary contributions from the developed countries. The Copenhagen Accord does not make clear the accountability of the financial mechanism to the Conference of Parties. And this whole question will continue. And they have indicated some funding, $30 billion in total between 2010 and 2012, and scaling up to $100 billion a year by 2020 from a multiplicity of sources, including the private sector. Now, what exactly is, how exactly private sector funding would count? Clearly, if it's a question of making the incremental investment supported by a feed-in tariff, now, is that to count as normal investment or is that to count as climate funding? There are questions, you know, to be addressed here. With respect to technology, the Indian position was that developing countries have full freedom to use flexibilities under the TRIPS for compulsory licensing of IPRs to address climate change. What the accord says that the financial mechanism would provide resources for technology transfer. So presumably this would include the purchasing of license rights. But it is silent on compulsory licensing, but then the developed countries had a contrary agenda of full respect for IPR's rights, in effect reducing the provision of the TRIPS. So this is, it is silent also on the developed country agenda, and in effect the existing TRIPS provisions continue. On forestry, our position was that resources are to be provided for sustainable forest management and afforestation, in addition to reducing deforestation and degradation. And there's an ambiguous formulation of Red Plus, but essentially the Indian agenda has been taken on board. Again,
but the fund provision was taken out.
Sorry?
There was a red fund that was proposed.
Yeah.
Got dropped in the end.
No, well, I mean, it would be one window in the total financial mechanism. So financial mechanism negotiations are to continue, but that the principle of resources to be provided not just for reducing deforestation, because we have, you know, we are actually, our deforestation is, rates are negative now, and it, you know, we are, you know, we need resources for both for sustainable forestry management and afforestation. And so essentially that agenda has been taken on board. The resources needed for adaptation are the same order as for mitigation, but India says that, look, you know, although we also need this, you can prioritize this for small island developing states and least developing countries, which these don't include us. And some significant resources certainly have been provided for adaptation, about half the $30 billion. And it is prioritized for LDC SIDS in Africa. We have no problem with that. But the new governance structure for adaptation funding, the existing governance structure under the Kyoto Protocol, has a majority for developing countries. This does not give a majority to developing countries. So there's a regression here with respect to the governance structure. Another of our agenda was no border measures and climate change mitigation considerations. Essentially, this is part of the US climate change bill, that if developing countries don't have the same mitigation policies as the US, then the US would be in a position to put in trade, you know, trade restrictions,
tariffs,
or put in tariff, put in, you know, border adjustment tariffs. The question of WTO consistency of these measures is a matter of considerable doubt. The accord is silent on this point, but clearly this can be pursued by national legislation subject to WTO provisions. And, you know, there is a critical link with the international accountability of actions for developing countries, and I can explain this in the Q&A if there is time. On the carbon market, there are numerous proposals for reform of the CDM and scale-up of the carbon market made by India. There's a simple reference to pursuing opportunities for using markets. This requires to be detailed subsequently and operationalized. Now, I have been giving these as Indian proposals. For the major part, they are supported by the entire group of developing countries known as the G77. But they are also the group of four major developing countries, China, India, Brazil, and South Africa, they are also fully in accord with every one of these proposals. So although these are cited as Indian proposals, they must be seen broadly as developing country proposals. So let me make a kind of personal overall political assessment of Copenhagen. India and the basic group. My own sense is that we have significantly but not absolutely protected our development space. We have emerged as a strong political force, collective political force, with common interests which may have significance beyond climate change. So for example, all four are now members of the G20 group, and this coalition could feasibly be carried on into the G20 negotiations. The US has obtained its international preconditions for passage of the Energy and Climate Change Bill in the US Congress, and which was the requirements for internationalized action by China and India and transparency with respect to their actions. And they also looked at the financial architecture to involve the World Bank and the existing MFIs. They seem to have got these. But of course, whether the bill actually gets passed or not is very much in doubt. The EU is a clear loser. And I believe that, excepting for the reference to the 2 degree stabilization level, none of its key objectives were met. And what were they? They were apportionment of carbon space distorted in favor of developed countries in perpetuity. In perpetuity, there would be a significant gap between the emissions of developed on countries and developing countries on a per capita basis. That was a clear EU agenda. They also needed comparability of mitigation actions with the US. They have clearly not got this. They wanted legally binding commitments of all developed countries and emerging economies. They have clearly not got this. They also imagined that they had a lot of political influence over small island developing states and LDCs. And these groups seem to have a mind of their own, and they did not fall in entirely with the EU agenda. And as far as the group of developing countries is concerned, the G77 group proved to be very fragile. Let's look very briefly at the development since Copenhagen. Now, well, the Danish Prime Minister and US Under Secretary General had written to all heads of state to endorse the accord, but the letter prejudges the eventual outcome, a legally binding treaty, which is clearly not acceptable to the basic group, clearly not acceptable to the US, and this is a EU agenda, as well as suggesting that actions and commitments are to be further negotiated and are not voluntary. This is completely contrary to the understanding of the US and the basic group. And this action has been criticized because they do not have a mandate with respect to the accord, which is not a UN decision. The Danish Prime Minister continues to be the president of the UNFCCC. The UN Secretary General has mandates over UN agreements. The accord is not a UNFCCC decision. They do not have the mandate to write this kind of a letter. And several developing countries have rejected the accord, and of these, Cuba has formally conveyed its rejection. But then, on the other hand, more than 100 countries have signified their endorsement. We have discussed this question of international consultation.
Has India responded to the letter?
Who?
Has India responded?
Yeah, I'm coming to that. Now, this is the position of the basic group. We support the accord, which is in the nature of a political agreement and not a legally binding agreement. And their interpretation is that it's a high-level political understanding among the participants on some of the contentious issues of the climate change negotiations. They affirm the centrality of the UNFCCC process and the decision of the parties to carry forward the negotiations on two tracks. And the negotiations must be carried out in an inclusive and transparent manner, meaning no more green rooms of 25 or 26 countries. The way in which the accord was done is not to be repeated. India has given its target, and it has also associated with the accord, and it has affirmed that the accord is not a new negotiating track but should give political inputs to the existing tracks. China has also has a similar view, and for that matter so has Brazil and South Africa. I mean, I've given the precise language, but basically they are very much on the same track. They have associated with the accord, the US, They have given a target of 17% by 2020 in relation to 2005. But they have made this conditional on anticipated US energy and climate legislation, and recognizing that the final target will be reported to the Secretary in the light of enacted legislation. So even the US, which holds that this accord is a voluntary target, it's a voluntary indication of what they might do, yet even this voluntary effort is conditional on the on their domestic legislative process.
That has to do with the powers of the president.
Sorry?
It has to do with the powers of the president. All international treaties have to be approved by the Senate. The
They have to be. Yeah, that's right. But the point is that, you know, the targets under the accord are not part of the treaty. These are to be voluntarily. Accord is not a treaty in the first place.
Yeah.
Okay. Secondly, that under the accord, countries are to voluntarily indicate the targets. So there is no element of an international agreement around these targets. So I would understand it that it doesn't, that the accord, neither the accord has to go to the Senate, nor does the target have to go to the Senate. But the point is, I think the US has left itself the caveat that if the US climate and energy and climate bill legislation is a no-go, then the US commitment will be zero. And the US actually views the accord as replacing the existing two tracks. They said, okay, now all those tracks are gone, we have the accord, and now we have to carry forward in line with this accord. The EU has associated with the accord, but what it has done is that it has reiterated its entire agenda, which failed to find place in the accord and which clearly, you know, was rejected, you know, by the, you know, in that process. Now I come to the end of my presentation. It is unlikely to be, the accord is unlikely to be operationalized without closure on the other two tracks, the long-term cooperative action and the ad hoc working group on Kyoto Protocol. We currently have the negotiation ongoing at Bonn, and they have taken inputs from the Copenhagen Accord and inserted them in the text as alternatives to the existing formulations. Of course, it's very clear that the announced goals are very modest in relation to the scale of the problem, but the key is the fate of the US Energy and Congress Bill, Energy and Climate Bill in the US Congress. And this is impacted by controversy over the IPCC findings, the Gulf oil spill, and of course the economic downturn. And also, of course, the US electoral cycle. The current electoral cycle does not permit it to be introduced this year. If it does not pass the next year, then I think all bets are off on the future of the global climate change regime. Thank you for your attention. I think I've taken much more time than I should have. Thank you.